tired. I took a nap.
Play is this?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Janet, and I'm president of the Guild Theatreworks. And I'd like to welcome you to the Guild Theatreworks production same time next year here at the Robert Anstead Cultural Arts Center. And we are very grateful to have it as our home. Could you please turn off your cell phones or any other devices? There is going to be an intermission of approximately 15 minutes in between the first act and the second. There's three scenes, intermission, and then another three scenes. Tonight's presentation is being directed by Barry Prague, and this is Barry's first directorial assignment here at the Cultural Arts Center, although he starred in our production last year of Moon Over Buffalo. And he's been doing theater and directing for a very long time. His association with us started when we were called the Brick Community Players back in 92, and we did The Mystery of Edwin Drood together. So we go back a long way, we theater people, and I understand there are some more theater people in the audience who've been acting for quite a while, so welcome. I also understand that Chris and Donna have an anniversary this evening. Chris, Donna, there they are. That announcement comes to you from Mr. Corey Crawford. You will see in a minute, okay? The bathrooms are down the hall. You can see you have to walk through the set, so if you can, hang on there and wait for intermission. Okay, in September 1st, it's the 15th anniversary of September 11th, and Corey Crawford, again, the name pops up, is producing a special benefit concert in honor of the veterans, the people who have served our country and keep us safe and allow us to do things like this and express our creativity. Song, dance, spoken word. It's going to be at the Civic Center, which is on Chambersbridge Road, and donations can be made at that time to the American Legion, who have several projects dealing with local veterans in need of specific help. So you can come out, enjoy music and dance, support our veterans, and help out a special person who's fought and put their lives on the line for us. So now sit back and wait to be entertained, and if you would like, you can sing along. You'll see what I mean when we start. So without any further ado, here we go with Same Time Next Year.
Thank you.
wait till we're alone, somewhere quiet on our own, so that we can fall the rest of the way.
I know that before the night is through, I'll be talking love to you.
That's a real sharp-looking outfit.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Did I wake you?
No, I was awake.
How did you sleep?
Fine, thank you. What time is it?
Oh, my watch is on the bedside table. Is 3 hours and 25 minutes fast.
Why don't you get it fixed?
Well, I was going to, but I got used to it.
Doesn't it mess you up?
No. I've always been very quick with figures.
Why are you looking at me like that?
We're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah?
Why do you have to look so luminous? It would be much easier if you woke up with blotchy skin and puffy eyes like everyone else.
I guess God figured chubby thighs was enough.
Look, this isn't just going to go away, yeah? We need to talk about this.
Okay!
Where are you going?
To brush my teeth.
Dorothy, please, sit down. No, please, just come over here and sit down. Now, Dorothy, I want you to know that what happened last night was one of the most amazing, wonderful experiences of my life, and I'll never forget it, or you.
Doris.
What?
My name is Doris.
Your name is Doris. I've been calling you Dorothy all night. Why didn't you tell me sooner?
Well, I didn't expect us to end up the way we did. And then, I did try to tell you, but you weren't listening.
When?
Right in the middle of everything.
It was incredible, wasn't it?
It was nice. Especially the last time.
I'm an animal. I don't know what came over me. What was wrong with the first two times?
What? Well, the first time was a little fast, and then the second... You know, I feel funny talking about this.
It was a beautiful thing, Doris. There was nothing dirty or disgusting in what we did.
Then how come you look so down in the dumps?
Because my wife is going to kill me.
How will she find out?
She knows.
You said she's in New Jersey.
It doesn't matter. She knows.
How?
Look, was it as incredible for you as it was for me?
Do all men like to talk about it a lot afterwards?
Why? Do you think I'm some sort of a pervert or something?
Oh, no. I was just curious. You see, I was a virgin when I got married. Well, sort of.
Sort of?
Well, I was pregnant, but I don't count that.
Doris, that counts.
No, I mean it was by the man that I married.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. Harry and me would have gotten married anyway.
Just speeded things up a bit.
You know, it turns out, I get pregnant if we even drink from the same glass. What's the matter?
Don't worry. Trojans are very reliable.
What?
I'm in a lot of trouble. I think I love you. I know, it's crazy. It's really crazy. I mean, I don't even know if you read Catcher in the Rye.
I didn't graduate high school.
See that? I don't even care. Of course, I should have known something like this would happen. You know, there's something about me I haven't told you.
What's that?
Well, when it comes to life, I have a brown thumb.
What do you mean?
Nothing I do turns out right. Ever. First time I had sex, I was 18 years old. We were in the back seat of a parked 1938 Dodge sedan. And right in the middle of it, we got rear-ended.
That's terrible. Did you have insurance?
You know the song that was playing on the jukebox last night, right when we met?
No.
If I knew you were coming, I'd have baked the cake.
So?
So? That's going to be our song. Other people would have gotten Hello Young Lovers or Be My Love. Me? I get If I Knew You Were Coming, I'd have baked the cake.
You're very romantic. I like that.
You know, it's crazy to think I love you and want to know my luck? I'm a happily married man.
Are you Jewish?
No.
How come you're so guilty?
Don't you feel guilty?
Are you kidding? Half my high school became nuns.
You know, Catholics have rules for this sort of thing.
Oh, we have rules about everything. That's what's so great about being Catholic. There is no right where you stand.
I tell you, Doris, I feel like slitting my wrists.
Are you Italian?
What is it with you and nationalities?
You're so emotional.
I happen to be a CPA. I can be as logical as the next person.
You don't strike me as the accountant type.
Well, you see, my life has always been a mess. Numbers are the only things that turn out right. I like that. What are you?
I'm Italian.
How can you be more emotional?
Oh, when you grow up in a large Italian family like mine, it's enough to turn you off to emotion for life.
I was wondering why you weren't crying or yelling.
Oh, I did before in the bathroom.
Crying?
Yelling.
I didn't hear you.
I stuffed a towel in my mouth.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. No use crying over spilled milk.
You're right.
Then why do we feel so terrible?
Because we're two decent people and this whole thing is tearing us apart. And I know it isn't our fault, but just keep seeing the look in my children's eyes and the betrayal. Keep thinking about the commitment my wife has made to me and the marriage vows that we made. And all the experiences we've shared together. You know the worst part of all this? While I'm thinking these things, I have this fantastic heart on.
Well, I really wish you hadn't said that.
I just think we should be totally honest with each other.
No, it's not that. Now I have to go to confession.
I mean, we must be crazy. I mean, this happens to millions of people every day. We're just two normal, healthy human beings who did a very healthy, normal thing. You don't use actual names in confession, do you?
No.
I ask you something?
Sure.
You go to bed with me again.
George, we can't!
Why not?
We'll just feel worse afterwards.
No, I'm over that. I just remembered something.
What?
The Russians have the bomb. We could all be dead by tomorrow.
George, you're grasping at straws.
No, Doris, we have nothing to be ashamed or afraid of. coming? Just a minute. Don't come in the closet.
Why not?
It's the first place they look. Try the bathroom. Be right there. Thank you. Doris. Doris.
You got a woman in there?
Ah! Oh, no. It's okay. I was very calm. It was old Mr. Chalmers with my breakfast. He didn't suspect a thing. Where were you?
I went out the bathroom window. Didn't he ask about your girdle?
What girdle? Oh, great. Now he probably thinks I'm a homo.
What do you care?
I stay at this hotel every year.
You do? Why?
Well, I have a friend who went into the wine business out here, and I come out every year on the same weekend to do his books.
From New Jersey?
He was my first client. It's a sentimental thing. I need to say something. Now, I know I must appear very smooth and glib, sexually. But ever since I've been married, it's the first time I've ever done anything like this.
Don't worry. I could tell. Oh, do you mind if I have some of your breakfast?
No, go ahead. I'm not very hungry. You know, this is funny. When I was single, I was never very good at these quick, superficial affairs. I mean, I always had to really like the person before.
Okay.
What do you mean you could tell? In what way could you tell?
Well, you know, the way you tried to take your pants off over your shoes and tripped and hit your head on the table. You know, just little things like that.
It's great to be honest with another person, isn't it?
It sure is.
I haven't been honest with you.
You haven't?
I told you I was married with two children.
You're not?
No. I'm married with three children. I just thought it would make me seem less married. I don't know. I just didn't think. But it's been weighing on me like a lead weight all morning. I mean, denying little Debbie like that. I don't do this kind of thing. I was under a certain stress. You understand.
Sure. We all do dopey things sometimes. How come your wife doesn't travel with you?
Oh, Phyllis won't get on a plane.
She's afraid of flying?
Crashing.
Why are you looking at me like that?
I love the way you eat.
Want to share some coffee with me?
Oh, no, thank you. Doris, do you think it's possible for two strangers to look at each other across a crowded room and suddenly want to possess each other in every way possible?
Yes.
No.
Then how did this whole thing start?
It started when you sent me that steak in the restaurant.
Well, they don't serve drinks, they're known for their steaks.
Then when I looked over at you and you toasted me with your fork with that big piece of steak on it, that really made me laugh. I've never seen anyone do that before. What made you do it?
Impulse. I never do that sort of thing usually. You know, I have a friend who says that life is all about saying yes. All I've ever been able to manage is maybe.
Then why did you do it?
Well, I was lonely and you looked so vulnerable. You had a run in your stocking and your lipstick was smeared.
You thought I looked cheap?
No, I thought you looked beautiful.
No, I really should go. The nuns are going to wonder where I am.
Nuns?
Oh, it didn't seem right to bring it up last night when we met at the restaurant, but I was on my way to retreat.
Retreat?
Yeah, I go to retreat every year at this time when Harry takes the kids to Bakersfield.
What's in Bakersfield?
His mother. It's her birthday.
And she doesn't mind you don't go?
Oh no, she hates me.
Why?
I got pregnant.
Her son had something to do with that.
Oh, she blocks that out of her head. You see, Harry was in his first year of dental college, and he had to drop out and sell waterless cooking. So now, every year he takes the kids to Bakersfield, and I go on retreat.
To think about God?
Oh yeah, sure, him too. You see, I got three little kids at home. Got pregnant the first time when I was 18, so I've never really had a lot of time to think about what I think, you know? Sometimes I think I'm crazy.
Why?
Well, take my life. I live in a two-bedroom duplex in downtown Oakland. I have a 1948 Kaiser, a three-piece blonde dinette set, a Motorola television, and we go bowling at least once a week. I mean, what more could anyone ask for, right? But sometimes things get me down, you know? Never mind. It's dumb.
I don't think it's dumb.
You don't? Boy, I can really talk to you. I find you saying things I didn't even know I thought. I noticed that last night when we met at the restaurant.
We had instant rapport. You noticed that too?
No. But we really hit it off. No, Harry's not much of a talker. How about you and your wife? Do you two talk a lot?
Doris, look, I know we're both very curious about each other's husband and wife, but rather than dwelling on it, letting it spoil everything, why don't we do this? I'll tell you two stories, one telling the worst side of my wife, one telling the best side, and then you do the same thing about your husband and we forget it, okay?
Okay.
All right, I'll go first. I'll start with the worst story first. Phyllis knows about us.
Now, you said that before. How could she know?
Well, you see, she has this thing in her head.
Ooh, like a plate?
A plate?
My uncle has one of those. He was wounded in the war, and they had to put a steel plate in his head. Now he says he can tell whenever it's going to rain.
I'm in a lot of trouble.
Why?
Because I find everything you say absolutely fascinating.
Tell me about your wife's steel plate.
It's not a plate. It's more like a bell. I could be a million miles away, and if I even look at another woman, Phyllis knows. I just know that last night at 1:22, she sat bolt upright in bed, and her head started going ding, 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 ding.
How did you know it was 1:22?
My watch said 4:47.
Tell me the good story about her.
Okay. Well, she helped me believe in myself. I know this may seem very hard for you to imagine, but I used to be very insecure.
How'd she do that? Help you believe in yourself?
She married me.
Aw, that was really nice of her. Setting you up and all.
Okay, your turn. Tell me the worst story first.
This is really hard.
Pick one?
No, to think of one. Harry's the salt of the earth. Everyone says so.
Come on, you owe me at least one rotten story.
Okay. All right, this isn't really rotten, but it was our fourth anniversary. We were having kind of a tough time. We had gotten in over our heads financially, and I was pregnant again, but we decided to have some people over to celebrate. Now, Harry does not usually drink, but that night he had 3 beers. It was right after the Gillette fights. And I overheard him talking to his buddies, and he said that his time in the Army were the best years of his life.
A lot of guys feel that way about the service.
Harry was in the Army for 4 years. 3 of them were in a Japanese prison camp. And he said it on our anniversary. Oh, he didn't mean to hurt me. I mean, Harry would never hurt anyone, but hurt.
you know? Promise me you'll never tell anyone that I told you that.
I won't tell anyone.
Okay, because I've never told anyone that before. Okay. Now you want to hear a good story about him?
Not really.
Come on, you have to. I don't want you to get the wrong impression.
Okay, fine. If you insist.
Okay. Now, Harry's this big, heavy-set sort of guy.
Oh, I wish you hadn't told me that.
Oh, no, he's as gentle as a puppy. Anyway, he likes to do something special with each of the kids, you know? He was having a really hard time coming up with something to do with Tony, our four-year-old. Then he got the idea to take him out to fly a kite. So one Saturday last winter, they went to the park, but there was no wind. Tony, who got bored pretty quick because he's only 4 years old, asked if he could go sit in the car. Harry said, sure. About an hour later, on my way home from the laundromat, I stop by and I see Tony fast asleep in the car. And Harry, all by himself in the park, all red in the face and out of breath, and he's pounding up and down with the kite dragging on the ground behind him. Well, it really got to me, you know?
Yeah. Helen has some wonderful qualities, too.
Who's Helen?
My wife.
You said her name was Phyllis.
So I lied. Helen, Phyllis, what does it matter? I'm married. I didn't want to leave any clues. I thought you might try to look me up or something.
Is your name really George?
My name? You really think I lie about my own name?
Yes.
That would be crazy.
You're crazy.
You know, it's funny. Here we are, alone in a hotel room, gazing into each other's eyes, and we're married with 6 children between us.
Oh, you got pictures?
What?
Of your kids.
Yes, but I really don't think this is the time.
I'll show you mine if you show me yours. I keep them in a folder we got free from Kodak. Where's yours?
Oh. Here, you have to take the whole wallet.
Is this the oldest one in the glasses and baggy tights?
Oh, that's Michael. Funny looking kid, isn't he?
Does he want to be Superman?
Peter Pan. Sometimes it worries me. Why is this one's face all scrunched up?
Oh, that's Paul. That was taken on a roller coaster. It's real natural looking, isn't it? Right after that, he threw up.
It's really something. I guess he looks a lot like Harry, huh?
Both of us, really. What's your little girl's name?
That's Debbie. That was taken on her 2nd birthday. We were trying to get her to blow out the candles on her cake.
She has her hand in the cake.
Yeah, need is not her strong suit.
You have some great looking kids, George.
Thanks. So do you.
Thanks. Just this one last time.
What?
It's my merry widow.
Your what?
Merry widow. It mashes you in and pushes you out in all the right places. But it cuts off all circulation so you can't breathe.
Well, let me know when you're coming out.
Right now.
Oh, wait, 1 minute.
Thank you.
Bake the cake, bake the cake. If I knew you were coming, I'd have baked the cake, bake the cake, bake the cake. If I knew you were coming, I'd have baked the cake. Happy anniversary, darling. Now go cut the cake and make a wish. Well, what did you wish?
I only have one wish.
What's that?
That you keep showing up each year.
You know, I have to say, that was one of the best ideas you ever had.
What, that we keep coming back here every year? I think either one of us can take credit for that. It's just something we stumbled into. As a matter of fact, that first year, I didn't think you were going to show up at all.
I was sure you would. Of course, back then I had a lot less confidence in my personal magnetism.
Where'd you get the champagne?
Oh, old Chalmers brought it while you were changing.
That's a bit risky, isn't it?
I think by now Chalmers knows the score.
You know, I really think he does. Every time I walk past the front desk, he winks at me.
that's not a wink. Chalmers has a tick in his eye.
Has a tick? Why didn't you tell me before now? For 5 years I've been winking back at him. What? You hate my hair, don't you?
I already told you I'm crazy about your hair.
It's not too blonde. I think next time I'm going into the city to have it done.
And how are the suburbs?
Muddy, mostly. Oh, everyone's so excited. Next week, they're hooking up the sewers. It's not exactly the life of Scott. We're surviving.
Oh, I see you started reading.
You don't know the half of it. I have joined the Book of the Month Club.
Good for you.
Sometimes I even take the alternate selections. How about you? Are you still in New Jersey?
Connecticut. We bought an old barn there and converted it.
How is it?
Drafty. Helen has the decorating bug. You know, I get this vision of my funeral right before they're going to close the lid on the casket. She's going to throw in two fabric swatches and say, "Which one do you like?" That's this year's bad story about her.
What else is new?
We had a little girl.
Oh, congratulations! You got pictures?
I knew you'd ask.
Oh, she's adorable. You know, it's funny. I still like looking at babies, but I don't want to own one anymore. You think that's a sign of maturity?
Could be. Oh, I saved one of these for you to give to Harry. It's from Havana.
Harry still thinks I go on retreat. What should I tell him? We have a Cuban nun? How are the kids? How's Michael?
Oh, crazy as ever. You know, he had a homework assignment to write about what he did on his summer vacation. Trouble is, he wrote about what he actually did.
Which was what?
Tried to get laid. He wrote in great comic detail about his unfortunate tendency to get an erection on almost all forms of public transportation. The school almost suspended him.
You're crazy about him, aren't you?
He's a very weird kid, Doris.
And he really gets to you. Admit it.
Hey, fine, I admit it. He's a nice kid. Thank you.
What was that for?
For everything. For this one wonderful weekend every year with no cares, no ties, and no responsibilities.
Gee, I just got all dressed up.
Oh, it doesn't matter if you can't find it. The tooth fairy will know. I want to be there to help you find it too, honey, but Daddy's working. in my room. Does Mommy know you're calling? Well, I'm sure she'll be back any minute. Yes, it's a very nice room. It has a piano and a sofa and a big comfortable bathroom. Oh, I wish I could help you find it too, honey, but Daddy has to finish his business. No, I love you too, sweetheart. Yes, goodbye. Goodbye. Oh God, I feel so guilty.
Debbie?
Her tooth fell out, now she can't find it. She's afraid the tooth fairy won't come. Oh, that thin, reedy little voice. Do you know what that does to me?
Oh, sure. That cheerful look on your face doesn't fool me for a second.
You think this is funny?
Honey, I understand how you feel. I really do. But I don't think it's going to help going on about it.
Doris, my little girl calls me on the phone and says, I love you, Daddy. And I answer her back with a voice still hoarse from passion.
I get the picture, George.
Don't you ever feel guilty?
Sometimes.
You never say anything?
I handle it in a different way.
How?
Privately.
You know, sometimes I think men are more sensitive than women.
Would you like some more champagne, dear?
I just think that women are more pragmatic than men.
What do you mean?
Well, they adjust to rottenness quicker. Anyway, you have the church.
The church?
Yes, you're Catholic. You can get rid of your guilt all in one sitting. I have to live with mine.
There is a lot about being Catholic you don't understand.
I tell you, when she started talking about the tooth fairy, it affected me in a very profound manner. Plus, I have indigestion, you wouldn't believe. It hit me hard, you know.
I have three kids too, George.
Yes, of course. I don't mean that you don't understand. I just think that my guilt is more acute than yours.
Honey, what do you want to do? Have a guilt contest? Is that going to solve anything?
What do you want me to do, Doris?
Well, for one thing, I think it would be a terrific idea to stop talking about it. It's only going to make you feel worse.
I couldn't possibly feel any worse. My little girl called me, that sweet, innocent little voice saying... You're right. Forget it. Talk about something else. Tell me the good story about Harry.
Okay, he went bankrupt.
How does anyone go bankrupt selling TV sets?
Harry has one failing as a salesman. He has this compulsion to talk his customers out of anything they can't afford. He lacks that killer instinct. Actually, it's one of the things I love best about him. He went into real estate. Your turn.
What?
Your story about Helen.
I already told you.
You only told me the bad one. Why do you always start with that?
It's the one I look forward to telling the most.
Tell me the good story about her.
Okay. Chris, our middle child, gashed his knee pretty badly on a lawn sprinkler, and Helen took us both to the hospital.
Both of you?
I fainted. The good part is, she never told anybody.
Do you faint often?
Only in emergencies.
Is it the sight of blood that...
Oh, please. My stomach is already squeamish. Listen. I just thought of something. Do you think if instead of leaving at my usual time, it would be okay if I left a little earlier?
When did you have in mind?
Now.
There's a plane in half an hour.
You want to leave 23 hours early?
Look, I know how you feel. Really, I do. I wouldn't even bring this up if you weren't a mother. You know, I wouldn't even think about it if this situation hadn't happened. It's not just the tooth fairy. I mean, she could have swallowed the tooth. It could be God knows where. Now, I know this kind of leaves you up in the air, but there's no reason for you to leave, too. The room is already paid for. Have you seen my hairbrush? Anyway, I'm probably doing you a favor. Even if I did stay, I wouldn't be very good company. You're feeling slightly rejected, right? I can understand that. But I want you to know that my leaving has nothing to do with you and me, Doris. I have a sick child at home. This is an emergency!
Will you stop it? This has nothing to do with the goddamn tooth fairy. You're feeling guilty, and the only way you can make yourself feel better is by getting as far away from me as possible.
Okay, fine, I feel guilty. Doris, we're cheating. Every year, we lie to our families and sneak off to a hotel room in California and commit adultery. Not that I want to stop doing it. But yes, I feel guilty. I admit it.
You admit it? You take out ads. You probably stop strangers on the street. I'm surprised you don't have a scarlet A embroidered on your jockey shorts. You think by talking about it, you can excuse what you're doing. You walk around like an open nerve saying, yes, I'm cheating. Well, look how guilty I feel, so I must really be a nice guy. And then you have the arrogance to think you're the only person in the world with a conscience. That doesn't make you a really nice guy. Do you know what that makes you? A horse's ass!
You know something? I liked you a lot better before you joined that Book of the Month Club. This isn't the end of the world, Doris. I'm not leaving permanently. I'll see you next year.
No, I don't think you will.
I don't believe this. Just because I want to leave early one time, you're willing to throw away a lifetime of weekends? How can you be so casual?
I don't see any point in going on.
Oh, no, don't do that to me. Don't try to manipulate me. I get enough of that at home. That's not what this relationship is about.
What is it about?
You don't know?
Yes, but it seems to be completely different from what you think it's about. That's why I think we should stop seeing each other.
You're serious?
What is the point of meeting in guilt and remorse? Where's the joy in that?
Doris, I have a commitment there!
And you have none here?
Here? I thought our only commitment was to show up every year.
Just two friendly sex partners? Who meet once a year, touch and let go?
Hey, maybe I'm kidding myself. I'm human.
So am I.
You're stronger. You always seem to be able to cope.
Do you know, over the last year, I picked up the phone to call you at least 10 times. I couldn't stop thinking about you. You kept slipping over into my real life and it bothered the hell out of me. More to the point, I felt guilty. So I decided to stop seeing you. At first, I wasn't even going to show up. Then I decided I at least owed you an explanation. So I came. And when you walked through that door, I knew I couldn't do it. And no matter what the price, I was willing to pay it.
I just feel so guilty.
I think you'd better leave now, George.
Doris, I love you. I'm an idiot. I suspect I'm deeply neurotic, and I'm no bargain. But I do love you. Will you let me stay? What do we do now?
Touch and hold on tight. Until tomorrow.
No, of course I haven't left Helen. I'm on a business trip. I come out here every year. No, I'm not running away from the problem. Yes, I know it's serious. Yes, I did see a doctor. He said it's no big deal. It happens to every man at one time or another. Look, if we're going to discuss it, you may as well pronounce it correctly. It's impotence, not impotence. What do you mean that I catch it in time? We're not talking about a terminal illness. It's a slight reflex problem. It's not a matter of nipping it in the bud. Look, we shouldn't even be discussing this. How did you find out about this anyway? What sort of hints? You asked her and she looked funny. Terrific. I don't want to talk about this anymore. I'm going to be fine soon. I just know it. I'm seeing an expert out here. I don't want to discuss this with you anymore. I'm going to hang up now. Goodbye, mother.
George,
I'll be right out.
How are you, lover?
Guess what?
Oh my God! What have you done to yourself?
Well, I can't take all the credit. It was a mutual effort. Honey, when you haven't seen an old friend in a year, isn't it customary to kiss him hello?
Yes, of course.
You okay, pal?
Yes. Just a little surprised.
You're surprised. I insisted on visiting the dead rabbit's grave. George, why are you in your robe and pajamas in the middle of the afternoon?
I'm rehearsing a Noel Coward play.
Something on your mind?
Not anymore. You must be 8 months pregnant.
Exactly. Honey, it's not that tragic. We'll just have to find a different way to communicate.
Great. You have any ideas?
Talk.
The talk I can get at home.
Well, sex I can get at home. And as you can see, that ain't just talk.
What is that supposed to make me?
What's the matter?
The matter? I'm the only man in America who just kept an illicit assignation with a woman who looks like a frigate in full sail. Just what was that crack about sex at home? Is that supposed to reflect on me? You think I don't have normal desires and sex drives?
Of course I do. I think you're very normal. Just saying that I look forward to this weekend all year long for a lot of reasons besides sex. I just love being here. Don't you?
Yes, of course. You know, you drive all the way up here in your condition, and I act like an idiot. I'm sorry. You should have thrown something at me. I'm sorry.
Anything else bothering you?
Nothing that I really want to talk about.
Listen, whenever we meet, it's always a little awkward at first, but
We usually solve that with some heavy through the sheets.
Look, if we're not going to do it, do you mind not talking about it?
I just meant maybe we need a different way to break the ice.
I'm wide open to suggestions.
How about this? I'll tell you some secret about myself that I've never told anyone. And then you do the same.
Okay, I think I've had enough surprises for one day, but go ahead.
You're gonna like this one. I've been having sex dreams about you.
When?
Just lately. Almost every night.
What sort of sex dreams?
Well, that's what's so weird. We're always making love, but it's always underwater. Swimming pools, caves, grottos, always underwater. Isn't that strange?
Always underwater, huh?
Yeah, it must have something to do with me being pregnant. Hmm. Now, your turn. You tell me some deep, dark secret about yourself.
I can't swim.
You mean literally?
Yes, I mean literally. When I say I can't swim, I simply mean I can't swim.
Okay, I was just asking. How come?
Just never learned when I was a kid. Helen found out when she pushed me off of the pier. My kids don't know. Every time we go to the beach, I have to tell them that my trick knee is acting up.
You have a trick knee?
No, but they don't know that either.
You see? It's working. Now we're talking? Like two people who've made love and everything. I'll tell you, that Ethel Kennedy must really like kids!
Look, I'm sorry about before. Really, I'm very happy to see you.
You want to tell me what's on your mind?
Well, may as well get it out in the open. It's nothing to be ashamed of. It's my sex life. You see, lately, Helen hasn't been able to satisfy me.
She's lost her interest in sex?
Oh, she tries. God knows. But I just get the feeling that she's going through the motions.
Any idea why this is?
Well, Helen's always had a lot of hang-ups about sex. She's always thought of it as a normal, pleasant function. It's a little twisted, don't you think?
Only if you're Catholic.
You're joking, but there's a lot to be said about guilt and shame. I think if you don't feel a certain amount of guilt, you're missing half the fun. Anyway, Helen has always viewed sex as a clean, healthy entertainment. No wonder she got tired of it. Anyway, my sex drive has increased while hers has decreased.
That's odd. Usually it's the other way around.
Are you accusing me of lying?
Of course not. Why are you so edgy?
Well, naturally I feel funny talking about it while she isn't here to defend herself.
Would you like to get to the more formal part of your presentation?
About Helen?
Yes.
Okay, I'll start with the good story.
You've never done that before. You must be meddling.
Doris, do you mind? Well, we went to London. And as we got to our hotel, we see a man out front in a formal coat and striped trousers. So Helen hands him her luggage and walks on into the lobby. Well, anyway, the man follows her in and explains to her very politely that not only does he not work at the hotel, but he happens to be the Danish ambassador. Without batting an eye, Helen looks at him and says, "Well, that's marvelous. That means you can tell us the best restaurants in Copenhagen." And he did. Point is, Helen doesn't get upset when she makes a total ass of herself. I admire that.
And what is it that you don't admire?
That damn sense of humor of hers.
Good. These are the stories that I like best.
Well, one night we had gone out to a party and had a few drinks, and when we came home, we started to make love, and nothing happened. For me. I couldn't
get the picture.
It's no big deal. Laugh. Anyway, half an hour later, as I'm getting ready to go to sleep, she looks at me and says, you know, when I married a CPA, I always thought it would be his eyes that would go first.
She was just trying to make you feel better.
Well, it didn't. Some things just aren't that funny. I guess the thing that bothers me most about Helen is that she broke my pecker.
You're impotent?
Slightly. Okay, now five people know. You, me, Helen, and her mother.
Who's the fifth?
Chet Huntley. I'm sure Helen's mother gave him a bulletin for the 6 o'clock news.
Honey, when did it happen?
Happen? We're not talking about a throughway accident. You don't just wake up one morning and say, oh shoot, the old family jewels have gone on the blink. It's a gradual sort of thing.
And you really blame Helen for it?
Of course not. I just couldn't think of a good way to bring it up. I was waiting for you to say, what's new? I was going to say nothing, but I can tell you what's old.
How's Helen reacting?
We don't talk about it much, but I get the feeling she views it as a lapse in my social responsibilities. You know, it's sort of like letting your partner down in tennis by not holding serve. I'll be okay, really. Patient's not dead. Just resting.
Patient's not dead.
That statement hardly calls for congratulations.
I need help getting up.
Oh.
Honey, I'm sorry. Is there anything I can do to make you feel better? Anything I can say?
Anything except it's all in your head. I'm no doctor, but I have a great sense of direction.
Okay, what do you want to talk about?
Anything but sex. How did you feel about getting pregnant?
Catatonic. Incredulous. Angry. Pragmatic. Finally maternal. Pretty much in that order.
Your vocabulary is improving.
Oh, you don't know. You're speaking to a high school graduate.
How come?
I was confined to bed for the first 3 months of my pregnancy, so it wasn't a total loss. I took a correspondence course.
You're really something, you know that?
You know, there's an ironic twist to all of this.
What's that?
Well, I didn't graduate high school the first time because I got pregnant. And now I did graduate high school because I got pregnant. It appeals to my sense of order.
I never realized you had a sense of order.
Well, that's unfair. I'm much better at housework now. I'm only 2 years behind on my ironing. It must be the nesting instinct. Anyway, the day my high school diploma came in the mail, Harry went and got me a corsage and took me out dancing. We didn't really dance. We lumbered. And then he took me to the malt shop and we got a hot fudge sundae. That's this year's good story about him.
Is he still selling real estate?
Insurance. He likes it. It gives him a chance to look up his old army buddies.
Honey, are you comfortable in that position?
When you're in my condition, you're not comfortable in any position.
Come on. Over here. Let's get you up by these pillows.
Thank you. How are the kids?
Oh, they're great. You know, Michael got a job with the Associated Press.
Oh, darling, that's marvelous. I'm so proud of him. What?
What?
Does my stomach offend you?
No, of course not. Tell me your other story about Harry.
I had trouble getting up the nerve to tell him I was pregnant again. When I did, he goes, great, there goes our old age. George, you're doing it again. What is it?
It's obscene.
What is?
I started to touch you. I got excited. I mean, what sort of pervert am I? I'm looking at a 200-pound pregnant woman, and I'm getting hot.
Well, I'll tell you something. That's the nicest thing anyone has said to me in months.
It's not funny.
Aren't you pleased?
Pleased? I feel like I did on my 7th birthday. My uncle gave me 50 cents, and I ran 3 miles, and then when I got there, the candy store was closed.
Doesn't this solve your problem?
The idea doesn't solve anything. It's the execution that counts.
I really got to you, huh?
Excuse me.
That's incredible. Are you as good as I think you are?
How good do you think I am?
Sensational.
I'm not as good as you think I am.
That piano's been there for 10 years and you've hardly touched it. Why today?
It beats a cold shower.
You play to release sexual tension?
You don't get this good without a lot of practice.
Come here. Come on. It's okay.
But Doris.
It's okay.
No, Doris, you can't.
I know that.
But how are we going to?
Don't worry, darling. We'll figure something out. Oh!
What?
Oh!
What is it? Doris? Doris, for God's sake, what's the matter?
Oh, if memory serves me correctly, I just had a labor pain.
You couldn't have! Maybe it's indigestion!
No, there's a difference.
How can you tell?
Indigestion doesn't make your eyes bug out.
But you can't be in labor! When does the baby do?
Not for a month.
My God, what have I done?
What have you done?
I brought it on! My selfishness!
You didn't have anything to do with it!
Oh, don't talk to me like I'm a child, Doris!
Stop getting so excited!
Excited? I thought I had trouble with my sex life before. You imagine what this is gonna do to it?
George, will you? Oh! Oh, I think I better lie down. Oh.
What kind of man am I? What kind of man would do something like this?
Do you mind if I say something?
Doris, I appreciate what you're trying to do, but nothing you say is gonna make me feel any better.
I'm not trying to make you feel any better. I'm gonna have a baby.
I know that!
No, I mean now. I have a history of short labor.
Oh, no! Oh, no, no! No? No? How do you feel?
Like I'm gonna have a baby!
It's a false alarm! It's gotta be a false alarm!
Quiet down. Get on the phone. Find out where the nearest hospital is.
Hospital? You wanna go to a hospital?
George, like it or not, I'm going to have a baby.
But we're not married. It's going to look odd.
Get on the phone.
Where are you going?
The bathroom.
Why?
No time to answer.
Hello, Mr. Chalmers, George Peterson. Get me the nearest hospital. This is an emergency. Well, something unexpected has come up. Well, it's my wife. See, she got pregnant, and now she's gonna have the baby. Get the nearest hospital, please. Hold on. Doris. Doris! Doris, answer me!
I'm busy!
Oh, yes, hi, I am, staying at the Sea Shadows Inn, when I heard a groaning sound from the next room, so I looked inside, and I saw a woman who I've never seen before in my life, and it appears that she's in labor, about 3 or 4 minutes apart. Just a minute. Doris! Who's your doctor?
Joseph.
Harrington.
Oakland. 5, 4, 2, 7, 8.
Right. Yes, I have a car and I can get her there. Right, thank you. Can you answer me one question? Would erotic contact in the final stages of pregnancy bring on premature... You know what? Just forget it. I was asking. Yes, I'll get her there. All right, Doris, they're phoning your doctor. He'll meet us at the hospital.
We're not gonna make it to the hospital. My water just burst.
Oh my God.
We're gonna have to find a doctor in the area.
But what if we can't?
You don't look so good. You're not gonna faint, are you?
Doris, I'm not a cab driver. I don't know how to deliver babies.
Now is no time to start acting like Butterfly McQueen. Get on the phone and find the local doctor.
Yeah, Chalmers, George, get the nearest doctor in the area.
This will teach you to fool around with a married woman.
It's okay, Doris. You're going to be just fine. Don't worry, you're going to be fine. His answering service? You don't understand. She's in the final stages of labor. Well, then get into your car and drive down to the goddamn golf course and get him. Just get him. Okay, the doctor is on the golf course, but it's just down the road, and Chalmers is gonna go get him.
Oh!
What?
I feel the baby!
No!
George, I'm scared!
Lean back and relax.
George, do something!
Be right back.
George! Don't leave me! George, I'm scared!
I'm here, honey. I'm here.
George! What are those for?
Honey, we're going to have a baby.
We?
Yes. Now I'm going to need your help. Give me your hand. Look into my eyes. I'm right here. Going to be just fine. You think I play piano well? Wait till you see how I deliver babies.
Wanna fuck?
What?
You didn't understand the question?
I understood. I just think it's an odd way of starting a conversation.
Yeah, I thought it'd be a great little icebreaker. Aren't you horny after your long flight?
I didn't fly, I drove.
From Connecticut?
From Los Angeles. We moved to Beverly Hills about 6 months ago.
How come?
A lot of reasons. I got tired of walking knee-deep in snow and trying to scrape ice off my windshield with a credit card. Plus, there are a lot of people out here with a lot of money. I have no idea what to do with it.
And you tell them?
How much you call a business manager.
How's it going?
Fine. Can't complain. Why?
You look kind of shitty. You all right?
Fine.
You sure?
When did you start dressing like an Indian? You look like a refugee from the Sunset Strip.
I went back to school. Berkeley.
Why?
You mean, what do I want to be when I grow up?
Well, you have to admit, it is odd becoming a schoolgirl at your age.
You think it's easy being the only one in class with clear skin?
What made you do it?
Oh, it was a dinner party that made me decide. Harry's boss invited us over. I just freaked.
Why?
Well,
I spent so much time with kids, I didn't know if I was capable of carrying on an intelligent conversation with anyone over the age of 5. So, we went. I was seated right next to the boss, of course. I actually impressed myself, though. He talked, I talked, you know, just like a real conversation. It was all cool. Then I noticed him looking at me in a weird way. I looked down, and I realized the entire time we'd been talking, I'd been cutting up his meat for him. That's when I decided it was time to get out of the house.
But why school?
Because I was feeling restless and undirected, and I thought school might give me some answers.
What sort of answers?
Like, where it's really at.
Jesus. Put that away.
What's the matter?
It's that expression.
Okay, to figure out who the hell I was.
You don't get those kind of answers in school.
I wasn't in school all the time. Protests and demonstrations were a learning experience in themselves.
Protests against what?
The war? Didn't you read about it? It was in all the papers.
Demonstrations aren't going to stop the war.
You got a better idea?
Look, I didn't come up here to discuss politics.
So far you've turned down sex and politics. Wanna try religion?
I think I'll try Librium.
George, why are you so uptight?
It's another thing I hate.
Uptight?
There's no such word.
You sound like my mother. When I was 9 years old, I asked her what the word fuck meant. She said, there's no such word.
And now that you know there is, you feel compelled to use it in every other sentence.
George, what's bugging you?
Bugging me? I'll tell you what's bugging me. The blacks are burning down the cities. I've got a Harvard professor telling my kids the only way to achieve happiness is to become doped up zombies. And I've got a son with hair so long from the back, he looks exactly like Yvonne DiCarlo.
That's right, honey. Let it all hang out.
Oh, that's another thing I wish people would stop doing. Letting it all hang out. Especially my daughter. I'm surprised she hasn't been arrested for indecent exposure.
It's a sign of age, George.
What is?
Being worried about the declining morality of the young. Besides, there's nothing you can do about it.
You can start by setting some examples.
What do you want to do, George? Bring back public flogging?
Wouldn't it be a bad idea? We could start with the movie producers. I mean, have you seen the films lately? Half the time, the audience achieves climax before the movie does.
It's natural to be interested in sex. You can't kid the body, George.
No, but you can be damn well firm with it.
As I recall, when you were younger, you weren't exactly a monk about that sort of thing.
Our relationship was not based on a casual one-night stand.
No. It's been 15 one-night stands.
No, it hasn't. We've shared things together. Helped each other. I helped you deliver your child, for God's sakes. Remember?
Remember. I consider it our finest hour.
How is she?
Very noisy, very healthy, and very spoiled.
You don't feel guilty leaving her while you go off to school?
Nah, Harry's home a lot. The insurance business hasn't been too good lately.
How did he feel about you going back to school?
Oh, when I told him I wanted to go back to school to get some identity, he said, you want identity? Go build a bridge. Invent penicillin. But get off my back!
I always said he had a good head on his shoulders.
That was supposed to be the bad story about him, George. How's Helen?
Fine. Just fine.
Tell me a story about how really rotten she can be.
That isn't like you.
Well, I think we need something to bring us together. Maybe you telling a bad story about Helen will make you appreciate me more.
Okay. Well, I had just signed this new client. Very proper, very old money. And he invited us over to his house for drinks with him and his wife to get acquainted. It was pretty awkward, but we got 3 drinks all right. Then when it was time to leave, instead of walking out the front door, I walked right into the hall closet. No big deal, right? Anybody can do that. Trouble is, I stayed in there.
You stayed in the closet?
Well, I wasn't sure they had seen me going in. I figured I'd just wait until they left, and I was in there for about a minute, and I realized I had misjudged the situation. So I opened the door, and there's the three of them standing there staring at me. All right, it was awkward, but I probably could have carried it off, except for what Helen did next. And want to know what Helen did next?
What did she do?
She peed on the carpet.
Oh, she did what?
Oh, not at first. She started to laugh. Then tears started streaming down her face. And then she held her sides and peed all over the Persian carpet.
What did you say?
I said, "You'll have to excuse my wife. Ever since her last pregnancy, she's had a bit of a problem." Then I offered to pay for the cleaning of the carpet.
Did that help?
They said it wasn't necessary. They have a maid for that sort of thing. You think this is funny?
I've been meaning to tell you for years, I love Helen.
Would she come off any worse if I told you I lost the account?
George, when did you get so stuffy?
Stuffy? Am I stuffy? Is that I don't want my wife to urinate all over my clients' carpets?
It's not just that. Look at you. You scream establishment.
Well, I am not a fatist.
What do you mean?
I'm not going to be like one of those middle-aged idiots with bell-bottom trousers and Prince Valiant haircuts who go around yelling, "Chow."
I wasn't just talking about fashion. It's talking about your attitudes.
My attitudes are the same as they always have been. I haven't changed.
Yes, you have. You used to be green and insecure and a terrible liar. Human. Now look at you. You're so sure of yourself.
That's the last thing I am.
Oh.
You know, the other day I picked up this magazine. There was an article in it about the quality of orgasms a woman should have. It was called The Big O. You know what really bugged me? This was a magazine my mother used to buy for its fruitcake recipes.
Times, they are a-changing, darling.
Too fast. Too fast. You know, 20, 30 years ago, we had standards. Maybe they were black and white, but they were standards. Today, it's just so confusing.
That's a step in the right direction.
When did I suddenly become appealing?
When you went from pompous to confused. Now tell me, sir, what's your pleasure? Walk on the beach? Dinner? Me?
You?
I thought you'd never ask.
Doris, you're not wearing a bra.
Oh, George, you're so 40s.
I'm an old-fashioned man.
Next you'll be telling me you voted for Goldwater.
I did.
You're putting me on.
Of course not. What are you doing?
If you think I am going to bed with any son of a bitch that voted for Goldwater, you're crazy.
Don't do this to me, Doris. Not now.
How could you vote for a man like that?
Can we talk about it later?
No, we'll talk about it now. Why did you vote for him?
Because I have a son who wants to become a rock musician.
What kind of a reason is that?
The best reason I can come up with in my condition.
Well, you're going to have to do better.
All right. He was going to end the war.
By destroying that whole country.
He never said that. That's the trouble with you people. You never listen.
It's a civil war. We have no right being there in the first place.
Oh, I'm so sick of all that liberal crap. We've got the bomb. Why don't we use it? Yes. Wipe the sons of bitches off the face of the earth.
I don't know anything about you. What kind of a man are you?
Right now, very frustrated.
Well, this time I thought I was going to bed with a liberal Democrat.
You told me you worked for Stevenson.
That was years ago.
What changed you? What happened to you?
I grew up!
Yeah, well, as far as I'm concerned, you didn't turn out too well.
Forget it, okay?
Forget it? How can I forget it? Are you being stuffy and old-fashioned is one thing, but being a fascist is another.
I'm not a fascist!
You're advocating mass murder!
Drop it, Taurus! Drop it!
You stand for everything I'm against!
Well, then maybe you're against the wrong thing!
You used to believe the same things I did!
I changed!
Why?!
Because Michael was killed! Trying to get a wounded man to a Red Cross helicopter. A sniper killed him.
When?
We found that at a July 4th party. Helen went completely to pieces. I didn't feel a thing. Thought maybe I was in shock and it would hit me later, but it never did. Never shed a tear. All I've ever been able to feel is blind rage. He was my son. And I loved him. I can't seem to cry over him. Isn't that something? Doris, I'm sorry about everything. Lately I've been a bit on edge. And it's just been one damn thing after another.
Amazing how great it can be after 20 years, isn't it?
Honey, you add up all the times we've actually made it. We're still on our honeymoon.
Did I tell you I'm a grandmother?
No, but you picked a strange time to announce it. Anyway, you're the youngest looking grandmother I ever had a peak experience with.
My mother thanks you, my father thanks you, my hairdresser thanks you, and my plastic surgeon thanks you. When Harry says, I'm not the girl he married, he has no idea how right he is.
Didn't Harry like your old nose?
Oh, Harry thinks this is my old nose.
He never noticed?
Pathetic, isn't it? Like a new dress, I can understand, but a whole nose?
Well, to be totally honest with you, I can't tell much difference either.
I don't care. It's different from my side. It makes me feel more attractive.
Why do you feel you need a validation of your attractiveness?
A woman gets to be insecure when she's 44.
45?
See what I mean?
Well, let me tell you my story about Helen. One night, it was this loud party next door, and Helen couldn't sleep. But she didn't want to take a sleeping pill, because she had to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning. So, she stuffed 2 sleeping pills in her ears. Overnight, they melted. The next morning, we were at the doctor's. And he says, as he's digging the stuff out of her ears, you know, these can be taken orally. Helen didn't care. She just laughed.
Honey, if that is the worst story you can tell about your wife, you must be a very happy man.
Well, let's just say I realize I have the potential for happiness.
Hello.
That's right, a brunch. No, we've catered parties for her before. We set up the tables around the pool, and there's room for the buffet on the patio. Hey, Liz, did Harry call? Okay, I'll be at this number. Sorry, busy weekend. Had to leave a number.
Does Harry know you're here?
No, Harry still thinks I go on retreat. Don't worry.
I'm not worried.
Then why are you frowning?
Because I'm getting bad vibes again.
Again?
Yes. You see, when you walk in the room, I noticed a certain high tension level. Then after we made love, there was a certain anxiety reduction. But now, I'm getting a negative feedback.
When did you go into analysis?
How did you know I went into analysis?
Just a wild guess. What made you start?
Well, my value system changed. You know, one day I took a look at my $150,000 house, three cars in the garage, swimming pool, and the gardeners, and I thought, did I really want this whole status trip? So I decided to really think about what I wanted, who I was.
So you went from analysis to echelon to gestalt to transactional to encounter groups to nirvana.
Doris, just because some people are trying to broaden their emotional horizons doesn't make the exercise any less valid. I've learned a lot.
I can tell. For instance, you've learned to talk to people as if you're reasoning with someone about to jump off a high ledge.
Well, sometimes to compensate for my former lack of emotionalism, I tend to overcompensate and lose some of my spontaneity. But I'm working on that.
I'm glad to hear it. What else have you learned?
Well, I've learned that around these walls that I've built up around myself, that I can be a very warm, caring, loving human being.
Honey, I could have told you that 20 years ago. How's Helen reacting to your voyage of self-discovery?
Oh, well, at first she tended to overreact.
In what way?
She threw a grapefruit at me in the A&P. Now, I understood we would have to go through some interpersonal conflicts, but now it's cool. She's into pottery.
What do you do for a living?
Doris, we live very simply. We don't need much. What bread we do need, I can provide through simple, honest labor.
Like what?
Well, I play cocktail piano at a singles bar in the valley.
Hello. Hi, Liz. No. You tell him that is our final offer. I don't care how good of a location it is. Liz, he needs us more than we need him. If he doesn't like it, tell him he can shove it. But don't worry, he won't. Okay, I'll be here. Bye. I'm buying a new store.
Why?
Money.
Is that why you went into business, to make money?
No. I wanted power, too. And it finally got through my thick skull that sitting through CR groups with 10 other frustrated housewives wasn't going to change anything.
CR groups?
Consciousness raising. I take it you are for women's liberation?
Hey, I'm for any kind of liberation.
That's a cop-out, and you know it. Women have always been exploited by men.
We've all been shafted, Doris, and by the same things. Let me lay this one on you. I go to a woman doctor. The first time she's given me a rectal examination, she says, "Am I hurting you or are you tense?" I said, "I'm tense." She said, "Are you tense because I'm a woman?" I said, "No, I get tense whenever anybody does that to me." Do you see what I mean?
I don't know. What I do know is the only time a woman is taken seriously in this country is when she has the money to back up her mouth.
Hey, I think it's great to have a hobby.
Hobby? We grossed over $500,000 the first year.
Don't get me wrong, Doris. If what you're doing makes you happy, that's great. I'm just not into the whole money thing anymore.
You ever get the feeling we're drifting apart?
No. In some ways, I never felt closer to you.
I don't know. Sometimes I feel like our lives are out of sync.
Doris, we all realize our potential in different ways at different times. If what you're doing gives you a sense of fulfillment, that's what's important.
Well, I'm working on it.
And you have everything you want.
With one minor exception. Somewhere along the way, I seem to have lost my husband.
Lost him?
Well, I don't know if I lost him or simply misplaced him, but he left home 4 days ago and I haven't heard from him since.
And, how do you feel about all this?
George, do me a favor. Stop talking as though you're leading a human potential group. It really pisses me off.
Hey, that's cool.
What's cool?
For you to transfer your feelings of aggression and hostility from Harry to me. As long as you know that's what you're doing.
You are really getting on my nerves.
Hey, that's cool too.
Jesus.
I mean it. At least it's honest. Total honesty is the key to everything.
Yeah? Are you being honest with Helen?
I'm trying.
So you've told her about us?
No. But I could. Really, I think now she's mature enough to handle it.
George, you're full of shit.
I can buy that. If you're being honest.
Oh, believe me, I'm being honest.
But wait, what was all that? I don't know if I lost him or simply misplaced him. What sort of crap was that?
Okay, you have a point.
So, how do you feel about all this?
You're doing it again, George.
I know I'm doing it again. How do you feel about this?
Okay. I think...
No. Don't tell me what you think. Tell me how you feel.
Like I've been kicked in the stomach.
Oh, that's good. What else?
Angry.
Uh-huh.
Hurt. Betrayed.
Oh.
And maybe a little guilty. Mm. But you know what? I resent the fact that he's making me feel guilty.
Why do you feel resentment?
I didn't marry Harry because he had a good head for business. It just turns out I discovered that I did. Or maybe I was just lucky, I don't know. The point is, I don't love Harry any less because he's a failure as a provider. Why should he love me any less because I'm a success? At least, I think that's how I feel.
You're not sure.
Harry's between Betty Crocker and Joan of Arc.
Hey, we're all going through transitional periods.
What do I do about now?
Have you told him that you still love him?
Love him? Why does he think I've been hanging around for 27 years?
Well, I just mean that right now, His masculinity is being threatened, and he just needs a validation of his worth as a man.
And how do I do that? I mean, that's some trick.
Total honesty. Is it so hard for you to let him know that you understand how he feels?
Right now? Yes, it is.
Do you want him back?
I don't know. Ask me tomorrow and I'll give you a different answer.
Why?
Because tomorrow I won't have you.
Doris, I'm always with you. In spirit.
Thanks a lot. It's kind of hard for me to hold feet on a spirit at night. Especially when he's 400 miles away.
Is that a proposal, Doris?
Why? Are you interested?
Are you?
I always thought we'd make a nice couple.
You didn't answer the question.
Hey, I'm the one who did the proposing, remember? But don't worry, I was only 3/4
Well, when you're completely serious, why don't you ask me again?
I bet you say that to all the girls.
No.
Thank you.
Stop feeling so insecure.
About what?
You're as feminine as you always have been.
Gloria Steinem's gonna hate me for this, but I sure am glad you said that. Guess I'm not as emancipated as I thought, huh?
Hey, none of us are.
You hungry?
Yes.
Well, you are in luck. Because tonight, our dinner is being catered by the chicest, most expensive French delicatessen in San Francisco.
Now, how do we manage that?
The owner's got a thing for you. It's in the trunk of my car.
Do you need any help?
Yes. Set the table, light the candles. When I come back, make me laugh.
I'll try.
Don't worry. If you can't make me laugh, just hold my hand.
Isn't here right now. Who may I ask is calling? Harry? Harry! Hold on. Hello, Harry. We're two mature adults, and I would like to talk to you. No, Doris isn't here at the moment, but I'd like to have a word with you. You see, I know you and Doris have been having some difficulties lately. Well, we're very old friends. We've been meeting. I've known her for the last 20 years, and through her, I feel as though I know you. Well, you see, we've been meeting every year on this weekend for 20 years, and the retreat? No, we'll get back to that later. I want to be totally honest with you, Harry. I need to say something. Doris loves you. She really does. I just know, that's all. Look, maybe if I told you a story that Doris just told me this morning, it might help you understand. See, a few months ago, Doris was supposed to serve as a den mother for your daughter's Indian guide group. Well, she got hung up at work, was 2 hours late getting home. When she got home, She walked inside and looked in the living room, and do you know what she saw? She saw a slightly overweight, balding, middle-aged man with a feather on his head, sitting cross-legged on the floor in a circle of totally engrossed little girls, gravely, yet gently, telling them what it was like to be a prisoner of war in a World War II Japanese prison camp. She didn't say a word. She turned around, walked outside, sat in her car, and thank God she was married to a man like you. Are you still there, Harry? Well, sometimes married couples get into an emotional straitjacket and have trouble expressing how they really feel. Total honesty is the key, Harry. I've known your wife for 20 years, and I'm not ashamed to say that it has been one of the most intimate and satisfying experiences of my life. My name? Yes. My name is Father Michael O'Hurley.
So good. So do you look tired? Are you all right?
The same as I've always looked. Just never noticed. I feel better now that I'm here. The room has always had that effect.
It never changes, does it?
Not the only thing that doesn't.
I find that comforting.
Even old Chalmers is the same. You know, he must be 75 by now. Remember when we first started coming here and we called him Old Chalmers? He must have been the same age then as we are now.
That I don't find so comforting.
We were very young.
Have we changed that much?
Of course. I grew up with you. Remember all those stupid lies I used to tell?
I miss them.
I don't. It was no fun being that insecure.
What about me? Have I grown up?
Oh, I suspect you're already grown up when we met. Tell me something. Why is it that whenever I'm near you, I want to put my hands all over you?
That's something else that's never changed. You always were a sex maniac. You sure you're all right?
Yes, I'm fine. You know, I'm doing some teaching at UCLA.
Music?
Accounting. The way things keep changing, figures are the only things that don't lie. Doris, why did you sell your business?
How did you know that?
I'll tell you later. What made you do it?
I was bought out by a chain. It was the right offer at the right time.
You don't miss the action?
Nah. I'm enjoying being one of the idle rich.
So what do you do with yourself?
I read, watch television, play some golf, visit my grandchildren. You know, jet set stuff.
But I thought you loved working.
There was another factor. Harry had a heart attack. No, it was mild, but he needed me at the time. Besides, it's not like I'm in permanent retirement. There's a local election coming up, and I've been approached to run.
On what ticket?
Independent.
Figures. Harry's okay now?
Oh, yes. He runs 4 miles a day, has a body like Mark Spitz.
Unfortunately, he still has a face like Ernest Borgnine. Can I tell you a good story about him?
Sure.
When they were wheeling him out of intensive care, he says, "Doc, give it to me straight. When I get out of here, will I be able to play piano?" The doctor said, "Of course." I said, "Well, that's funny. I couldn't when I came in." See, Harry's not one to tell jokes, but he saw how panicky I was, and he wanted to make me feel better.
So, how are you and Harry? Emotionally?
Comfortable.
Comfortable?
It's not such a bad state. That word has been given a bad reputation by the young. George? Where's your luggage? Did you leave it in the car?
I didn't bring any. Doris, I can't stay.
Why not?
Look, I have a lot to say and not much time to say it, so I may as well get started. First of all, Helen's known about us for 10 years.
When did you find that out?
2 months ago.
She's never confronted you with it before?
No.
Well, what made her tell you now?
We have an old friend, Connie. Have I ever told you about Connie? Connie told me. 10 years, and she never even let on that she knew. Maybe the nicest story I ever told about her.
Your wife is an amazing woman.
She passed away, Doris. I lost her about 6 months ago. It's all very fast. I'm sorry to blurt it out like that. I just couldn't think of a graceful way to tell you. Are you okay, honey?
It's funny. I never met Helen. I feel as though I lost one of my best friends. Isn't that strange? How are the kids?
They'll survive. I tell you, couldn't have gotten through this without them.
I wish you would have reached out for me.
I did. That's how I found out you'd sold the stores. I called there. They gave me your home phone number. I dialed and let it ring about 4 times and hung up. But it was nice to know you were there if I needed you.
You should have spoken to me.
I didn't want to intrude. I didn't feel that I had the right.
God, that's terrible. We should have been together.
Doris, I've been thinking about us a lot lately, and all the experiences we shared and times we spent together. You know, we've made love 113 times. I figured it out on my Bomar calculator. You know, it's wonderful to know a person so well. There isn't a thing about you that I don't know. It's 2 sugars, right?
No, 1.
Okay, so maybe I don't know everything about you. I don't know who your favorite movie stars are, and I can't think of the name of your favorite perfume. I racked my brain, but I just can't remember it.
That's funny. It's my sin.
But I do know that in 24 years, I've never been out of love with you. I find that incredible. So what do you say? Want to get married?
Married? We shouldn't even be doing this.
I'm serious.
You are, aren't you?
Do you think I was? Summer romance? Simple yes will do.
There's no such thing.
What is it?
I was just thinking of how many times I dreamt of you asking me that. It's actually got me through a lot of bad times in my life. I want to thank you.
What did you say all those times?
I always said yes.
You're hesitating now? Do you realize I'm giving you the opportunity to marry a man who's known you for 24 years, can't walk past you without wanting to grab your ass?
You always were a sweet talker.
Because if I told you how I really feel, it would probably sound like a medley of cliches from popular songs. Will you marry me?
Can't.
Why not?
Because I'm already married.
You stay because you feel he needs you?
No. It's a lot of things. Affection, respect, a sense of continuity. We share the same memories. It's comfortable. end, that's what marriage is all about. I don't know.
Can you tell me why I had to be so stupid and help you get back together 5 years ago? And why did I have to be so damn generous?
Because you felt the same way about Helen then as I do about Harry now. And you knew if I didn't go back, you would have been stuck with me permanently. And that thought terrified you.
You always could see right through me, couldn't you?
That's okay. I always loved what I saw.
I want you now.
And you can still have me. Once a year, same time, same place.
Doris, I need a wife. I'm not the kind of man who can live alone. You know, when I came here, I wanted to marry you, but I knew there was a chance that you would say no. I guess what I'm saying is, without you, I'll probably end up with Connie. Connie knows all about you. Point is, she's not the kind of woman that would deal with our situation. Guess what I'm really saying is, we'll probably never see each other again. You're trembling.
Thought of never seeing you again terrifies me.
For God's sake, Doris, marry me.
I can't.
I wish I could think of something that would break your heart, burst into tears, and run away with me.
You know us Italians? Mm-hmm. We never cry.
I have a plane to catch. What time is it?
No, it's 3 hours and 25 minutes fast.
How long have you been doing that?
20-odd years.
And why would anyone do a thing like that?
Personal idiosyncrasy.
Who are your favorite movie stars?
Lon McAllister, Cary Grant, Marlon Brando, and Laurence Olivier.
On a long way, Doris.
We both have.
So, always keep your watch 3 hours and 25 minutes fast, huh? I can't believe this is happening to us. Damn it.
What about Connie?
Connie's 89 years old. Look, I just thought I wanted to marry you, and I figured if you thought someone else wanted me, I might stand a better chance. I was desperate. Okay? For once in my life, I wanted the happy ending. I don't want to talk about it anymore. I'm back. And I'm going to keep coming back every year until our bones are too brittle to risk contact.
Let's say it, come on.
Thank you for the slippers.